Well, it started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
Partly sunny skies, some clouds in the background there, looking southward here at Gulfstream Park. A little bit of a breeze as well coming in off the Atlantic Ocean, just a few furlongs east of us here, and a flock of birds in the background. We've got it all here at Gulfstream Park, including a nine-race Friday card. Now, that turf course, which took a little rain this morning, it was brief, but a pretty heavy downpour, and no worse for the wear is this main track, which will be fast by the time we roll around for race number one at 12:05. That turf course will lay somewhat dormant until race number six at about 2:30, 2:35 p.m. on this Friday, July the 17th. Jason Blewett catching up with all of you beneath the bright lights of our third floor clubhouse studios. Wherever you're watching, we absolutely appreciate it, and we do move forward into another weekend here, continuing on in the month of July of 2020 at Gulfstream Park. Before we go any further, we got to bring in the man downstairs, the one, the only Ron Nicoletti, and I'll tell you, Ronnie, solid Friday card lined up, and that'll set us up for a solid weekend here with a 12-race Saturday that includes that nice Sea of Tranquility Stakes.
Yeah, Sea of Tranquility Stakes. It looks like it's got a really couple of nice horses in there. On Sunday, we actually have a mile-and-a-half turf race. That's a little further down the weekend, so it'll be good for everybody, too. If you like turf racing, we got it all here. As you said, starts in race six today, our turf racing.
Yep, absolutely. Obviously, you can see the graphic, given the rain we had. Again, it was intense, but it was very brief. The option was just to take that first race off, and we'll hit the green stuff to kick off the late pick four on this nine-race Friday afternoon, and a scenario where there are just there's a lot of opportunity in terms of the multi-race wagers, and we'll stack that $100,000 guarantee. We'll stuff the money in a bag, and there's the rundown as far as a 3:23 start time for the July 17th Stronic 5 with race number 6 up at Laurel Park.
Yeah, we got two here from Gulfstream Park off our late daily double, actually races 8 and number 9. So as you always say, it takes about 50 minutes and you can get about $8,000, it seems, almost every week.
Yeah, so easy money and quick money, right?
Yeah, you get it quick if you can figure it out. Boy, does it pay nicely.
All right, so looking forward to that, and we do have our two races, our late double, in fact, holding down the fort locally in the Stronic 5. Now, as far as moving forward into the early pick 5, this is a very difficult first race. There's just not a lot of dirt form to land on in this spot, and I do like a horse who is currently, 5-1 right now. I prefer the 7, Astromelia, who has not raced in about 7.5 months. That's a bit of a concern, but I've got two horses mid-pack and outside, and I'll keep my fingers crossed in that off-the-turf first race. Scheduled dirt affairs coming up in the second, and I built this ticket, Ronnie, around a single and I think a very worthwhile favorite and very likely winner at a short price in the 5 Tiger, who, boy, his first start, although he lost, wasn't that a good effort out of him?
Yeah, just beating that less than a length in there, stretching out to 5.5 today. It looks like he's going to be dangerous in there.
Yeah, very dangerous second out for Arundel. And then I've got basically a logical spread in the third, and the same could be said for the fourth. But very much looking forward to the 5, a Tiger back in the mix in his second start. Again, this first race is a bit of a crapshoot because it's not a 6-horse field. In fact, you go with 10, and you just don't have any dirt form, certainly recent dirt form to hang your hat on. That was the appeal just as far as a horse who's run pretty well on the main track, all things considered, as to why I took the 7, Astromelia, although I fully admit 7.5-month layoff in a spot like this. I don't love that. I didn't know where else to go.
Yeah, tough. I went with the speed in here, and I think this horse might be currently 5-2 on the board. That was my number two, my first ex-wife, who's cutting back to 5 furlongs on the dirt after setting the pace and fading. That was against similar going. That was going the mile on the turf. This horse has run well at the shorter distance. All of those on the turf. So guesswork at Sandra Mattier. You got Hector Berrios up. I just thought the speed, the 7, for the reasons you mentioned, Astro Amelia showed promise on the dirt both here and at Gulfstream Park. But it was a long time ago. Figures on the main track today. Then I went to the horse that's main track only. You have in second or you have in third. I actually have the 13th, fourth, the 12th Merengue in third in there. Just guessing with the two horse, that might be some speed in there.
We'll see. That's the first race. The second is a Florida-bred maiden special weight as we follow. And we'll take a trip back as we rejoin everybody after the first break. We'll look at yesterday's Schuylerville Stakes again with a big recent Gulfstream Park graduate and day out of the office who just ran terrifically well at a very big price for trainer Tim Hamm. So again, the riding high into this second race and feeling pretty good and prideful about the two-year-old program we have here in this part of the country throughout the spring and summer months. And Arundel is a big part of the fabric in that regard. They've got a lot of homebreds and evidently, they've got a colt by Dialed In who's pretty good. Wanted to go back and take a couple of different looks at Tiger, even with him being a big favorite, and ultimately show the start off the bat. And it may not look all that obvious in the running line, but this was a horse who was just a little lethargic early from that inside post. There was a bit of a stutter step start for him, and it clearly put him in a spot where he had probably never been before. I mean, chasing down inside, taking the kickback. He does not back down, and the horse that beat him down on the rail, Son of a Beast, who was slightly favored over him at 3-2 odds, let's keep in mind, was a Todd Pletcher-trained first-time starter. Just a big effort with the respectable figure, obviously, Ronnie, for Tiger, who's going to be a massive favorite.
Yeah, Juan Alvarado, of course, the trainer. You got MSC El Jaramillo in the saddle today, and I just stretch out to 5.5 furlongs, certainly going to help this afternoon. And as you said, probably a lot of people single in the early pick five. I use the 6 and 2nd Full Send, who's stepping up and stretching out, rallied to finish second against that course that won impressively, Cal Salsa. It was a 50 sprint going 5 on the main track. It's Mike Yates, Alberto Burgos in the saddle, and then Spear Gun because it's Ralph Nix on top of it, you know, on the ticket.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now the third, completely different kind of race as we stay on the dirt again on the fast main track for the first 5 this afternoon. Our turf racing begins in race number 6, but you've got a field and some older hard hitters in this 12-5 to 10-5 claiming race, which I think, and I like that we have a bit of a disagreement here. This was a race for me. I had a tough time really getting a full grip on some of like the major back class horses, mainly the 3 Quixote and the number 7 Cajun Firecracker, who I think as a whole, their form has steadily declined. And although this might be a bit of a step up when you consider some of the past resumes for a horse like the 1 Why Are You Awesome, ostensibly speaking, I don't know how much tougher this field might be because I just didn't like the recent form of just about everybody in here. He's coming in off a race, and we'll look at it. I mean, this is an OG-type son of YYY. He's danced a lot of dances with 63 starts under his belt and 12 victories. He's coming out of a race. Yeah, I know he won for 62.50, but Northern, who was third, came back to win. In fact, he'll be coming back favored in the 4th race, and we'll be looking at his last out victory. And this horse got a pretty good figure. So, again, although on paper this says there's a horse that's jumping from 62.50 to 12.5, I just don't know how big of a jump this really is because I don't trust some of these other horses that have maybe the stakes of yesteryear type resumes.
Yeah, I got a little bit of a long shot, and he had the same trouble with this race. Didn't really know how to go. I went with the 5 Tiz Approved, who's 5-1 on the morning line. Turning back to 6 furlongs, he had a real nice 3-race win streak, sprinting on the Tampa main track, ended when he opened, and he surrendered that early 2-length lead against those 25 optional claimers. That was going a mile here. It was on a good track that afternoon, and I just think the drop down to the 12-5 level looks like a nice spot for this horse, so taking a bit of a shot with the number 5 Tiz Approved. improved on top of my ticket.
We'll see. He had a big glass jaw last time out. I mean, he came here on a roll with the big figure at Tampa and was just buried in a race where he made a pretty easy lead. Does he wake up in for the 12-5? I see you've got the 7 Cajun Firecracker, who Safi had claimed this horse last September in Kentucky and won a few races with him, claimed for 50, right around Fountain of Youth time, and lo and behold for Mike Maker, now went for the 12-5.
Yeah, big drop this afternoon, dropping to this level after facing tougher in those two races since he was claimed for, as you mentioned, $50,000 in February. Mike Maker, MSC El Jaramillo, won another horse. I think the drop is going to help this afternoon for sure. They're going to lose some money, but I put Cajun Firecracker on the ticket along with Dark Ages and the number 2 Stonehand, who's going to the Jorge Delgado barn.
All right, tricky little race in the fourth. We'll take a familiar page in the nightcap, but more on that in a few seconds. We'll take a little breather here on Gulfstream today. Back with the Rainbow after this.
Now the field is at the top of the stretch, and it is Make Mischief, Day Out of the Office, then Hurrah. On the outside is Hopeful Princess as they move down for the eighth pole. And here's Day Out of the Office to take over the lead. Then Make Mischief, and on the outside, Hopeful Princess. Day Out of the Office, all business to win the 102nd Schuylerville. Make Mischief was second, and Hopeful Princess finished third.
Well, the great John Imbriel with the call. Happy for Johnny I getting to call his first ever full-time Saratoga meet. And wouldn't you know it, Ronnie, on opening day, as we welcome everybody back to this Friday edition of Gulfstream today, you had a recent GP 2-year-old filly graduate and Day Out of the Office who, again, poured it on in deep stretch, got an 82 buyer for that performance beneath Junior Alvarado.
Yeah, it was just very impressive. And I heard that Tim Hamm, of course, the trainer, afterwards said he did not want to run this horse at 4.5 furlongs, which he did here. He was sort of forced into it. When the horse ran so impressively, he just put this horse, this race on his calendar, and this was the race he wanted to win. And boy, did he win it. He was just drawing away from the field.
No, she's a nice filly.
Really
absolutely
nice.
No, daughter of Into Mischief, who, again, for an early season 2-year-old race up there for the fillies, got an 82 buyer. That race came up fast and just got off the phone with trainer Tim Hamm right before we came on the air. He was curious if he was going to be at Gulfstream today, wanted to do something on the air because he's got him elect in the fifth race, a firster, 2-year-old firster by Flat Out, and he called me back right away. I sent him a text and said, I'd love to tell you I'm on a private plane right now flying back to Fort Lauderdale or Miami, but truth be told, is on the van with Day Out of the Office, and they're cruising down 95 South, but he seems like a real good guy. And I'll tell you, Ronnie, maybe a barn I wasn't super familiar with before 2020, but he did a good job here, has done an excellent job with his 2-year-olds and even some of his other Tampa Bay shippers. Very good trainer.
Yeah, very good trainer and a really nice guy, too. So we'll see him when he gets back, I guess.
Yeah, no, I got a rain check with him next week. We'll do something on the air, do a little interview action, and obviously has a nice filly. And good to see the Gulfstream Park graduates winning two of the last three Schuylervilles with Catherine the Great back in 2018. Now, speaking of Gulfstream and synonymous here with our race course in Hallandale Beach is the Jackpot Rainbow Six. We've got the guarantee of $600,000 this afternoon, just a 9-race card, so it begins in the fourth race. And how's this ticket looking, Ronnie?
43.20 for me, and I did go too deep in here. I think the logical two is Northern, who you mentioned in the last race, and Game Boy Benny for Pedro Zobazo moving to his barn. Three deep in race number 5 with Ernesto, Dang It, and Gospel Municipal House. And 3D, again, in race number six, pretty wide open affair, even though there's a 2-1 favorite in there, Imperial Moment. I also like Maverick Kitten. And on the outside, Traceability. Went too deep in race seven with Our Prerogative and Talk the Talk. And then in race number eight, too deep again with Hairball and True Harris. And 3D in the last, that's part, both the eighth and ninth are part of the Stronic Five this afternoon.
Now, Northern, having shown, Ronnie, a few seconds ago, and your ticket obviously clocking in at 43.20, but looking at Northern, there's a lot, there are quite a few parallels checking out this horse's overall resume with even the 9-year-old, Why You Awesome. And I wanted to give both horses some acknowledgement because I'm a fan of these older gelding lower level claimers that will never win an Eclipse Award, but I don't care. They hit hard and they are the heart and soul of the game here this time of the year in South Florida. Now, Northern is the horse to beat, who's held his form quite well, has had prior success here at Gulfstream Park, and seems to just quite simply be no worse for the Ware now is a 6-year-old and a 14-time winner, returning to Hallandale after spending the winter at Tampa Bay Downs. Here he is last time out with Sammy Camacho riding for trainer Ken Sweezy. This horse, I mean, you talk about a horse that'll just peck away with the body blows and will just stay on you. I mean, he's as game as they make him, Northern, and he caught a solid spot, I think, Ronnie, to look for two consecutive victories.
Yeah, and he's turning back to one of his better distances today, which I really like. He's had five races with four wins, and you saw that. He held sway to defeat this level of competition. That was going 3/4 mile. He's an 8-time local winner. And you go through his past performances. He's shown in the past that he could string together back-to-back victories. So he looks awful tough in there for me at this $6,250 level.
He's going to be favored. You've got three main horses. Obviously, Northern, Game Boy Benny, who defeated Northern, actually. They had all chased Why Are You Awesome in that replay we looked at for the third back on June 14th. He looks logical. And then you've got the 8 Little Meatball. Is he this level stepping up and trying tougher after defeating those dated claimers last time out? Probably a slightly easier spot, don't you think, that he's coming out of?
Yeah, definitely. He that race got him back on track. He hadn't won since Gulfstream Park West, and he got back. He put him in that dated claimer, and I was surprised he won and the way that he won in that race. So I added him a little further down. Now, I did have Dr. Harlan in third, so I bumped up Little Meatball into that spot.
Yeah, that's a notable scratch for sure, absolutely. I had Dr. Harlan in the mix as well. Now, the fifth race, we'll start this late pick five at a real crossroads here with the early five, late five, and Rainbow Six all converging in this race because it is a 9-race Friday. Using two firsters, the Tim Hamtrain firster on the rail by Flat Out, and you might suspect going into this or speculate the 3 Honesto is going to be pretty live for trainer Danny Pito, whose 2-year-olds have been good this year, along with trainer Tim Ham. They both have a couple of nice 2-year-old fillies. Anchored and built this thing around, although not a lock, I do like the 3 Imperial Moment, who I think second off the van in from Fairgrounds, a slight dip in class. He's going to be a reliable type favorite there for trainer Louis Russell in the sixth race. He is my anchor, my building block, a single, if you will. Coverage in race 7, I used, and I think in the 8th, which is obviously also a crossroads in the Stronic 5, you get the best of both worlds with the rail horse in True Harris, I believe. Yeah, True Harris on the rail, who's, I think, the best closer, and the best horse and best speed is the 3 Airball, and I think they complement one another quite nice, and I was thoroughly confused in the nightcap, therefore I used 4 horses, I think the only 4 horses that are going to be under 10-1. And going 3, 4, 8, 10 to close this thing out. But let's get on to the fifth, and I think the pecking order probably has to start with the Miguel Vasquez-ridden Dan Pita train number 3 Honesto, who for GPW Works has got a pretty glib-looking tab, don't you think, coming in from Miami Gardens?
Yeah, it's his son of Kozan debut for Dan with a series of, as you mentioned, solid workouts over the GP West training track. Miguel Vasquez will be in the saddle this afternoon. His horse was scheduled to run the other day. They scratched out for this spot this afternoon, so we'll see how Honesto runs first time over the track.
Ahim Elek is down on the rail for Tim Ham, coming in from Tampa. And I asked him when I was on the phone, I said, hey, what about the first you got in the fifth, whose work tab looks good enough coming in from Tampa? and as a son of flat out, is getting to go 5.5 furlongs first out, which in my mind is probably a better fit than 4.5 to 5. And he told me that they had brought this horse to sell, or at least put in the sale, the OBS 2-year-old in training sale, yet he came down with a little bit of an issue, got a little sick, so they scratched him out of that sale. But he said, I really like him. He's trained like a good horse. So Barn obviously has an unbeaten graded winner now in Day Out of the Office, but I'm going to go into this, much like the Peter Furster, thinking the rail horse is live, too.
Yeah, just got to deal with that tough inside post. But certainly, if Tim likes him, he's done a good job with his two-year-olds thus far. So it's good to hear that he said that. I did use the number 5, Dang It, in second. He's eligible, I think, to take a step forward. Chased the pace last time, finished fourth behind that horse that seems to be a common feed, Casalsa, in a 50 maiden test going 5 furlongs. Fernando Abreu, he's pretty solid with horses making their second start. Limited sampling, 20%, so I threw that one on the ticket.
Let's move on to race number 6. This will be the turf opener, obviously fairly late on this July 17th program. Post of about 235, 240 Eastern, give or take, with this $50,000 to $40,000 maiden claiming race. And although you have a horse that I singled and we both picked and a favorite here, no question about it, in the 3 Imperial Moment, it's not a one-sided affair. Horses like the 10 Maverick Kitten, maybe the 11 7 Channels, are going to get bet a bit. But in the case of Imperial Moment, for a barn that's just been so adept at properly spotting their runners here this meet, going back to the post-Florida Derby, few weeks after the Florida Derby and Louis Russell, you got to think this Colt by American Pharoah is going to run even better than he did last time out. Things just didn't go his way. No, he was favored in this race, which we'll check out. And this wasn't the worst trip you'll ever see, but he was hung out to dry, more of a 3 to 4 wide chasing type speed around both turns in this race. And although he was rather, I thought, one pace with no real punch off the far turn, he never really packed it in. And when you consider, Ronnie, he's got the benefit in hindsight of having this race over the course, maybe a little more time to acclimate to South Florida. He looks, don't you think he looks solid in this race?
He does. I mean, I just thought, like you said, with the 10-horse Maverick Kitten, I'm talking about, I got this one, I think, can definitely win in here. But I just thought with the 10 Maverick Kitten dropping in for the $40,000 tag, showed some promise for Mike Maker before the layoff. That a horse, I just couldn't single this horse in my Rainbow Six. But the one to beat, yes, Maverick Kitten. I also use traceability. Almost sprung that 44-1 upset last time out for Joe Cantonese. So I threw that one on the ticket, but the race does go through Imperial Moment.
Definitely. I mean, the 310 might just be over in their own little corner and are going to be the two favorites for sure. And then Joe's horse, traceability, that was the Joe Cat exacta, Ronnie, that paid like close to 2 G's, right, for a deuce?
Exactly. It was amazing. They were this close too in that race. So
they were both around 40 to 50 to 1 too in that spot. That was pretty wild. Back on the dirt for the 7th. We'll move on to this $25,000 3 and up Philly Mare claiming race. And there's a horse that's got speed who's just dipping down in class in the number 5 R prerogative. I know you've got the stat with Georgina. It might not tell the full story because this filly by Drill is dropping out of an allowance condition, but it does feel like the intangibles along with the good stat are there, and she's the starting point as far as the dialogue goes.
Well, I originally had the 4-horse Cozy Dreams on top of my ticket, so I scratched into R prerogative, and I'll show you that stat right now. This is amazing stat to me. Georgina Baxter, layoff of 61 to 180 days on the dirt again with claimers. 40%, 71% in the money, and a 276 return investment. She always does good with horses coming off the bench, and I think the stretch of the 4 Cozy Dreams makes this horse strictly the one to beat with that speed.
Who's the danger? I think the 3 Flashing Diamond is going to run pretty well in this race, along with the rail horse, the 1 Talk to Talk, and you're obviously in the same boat.
Yeah, I just thought the 1 Talk to Talk proved she could compete at this level when she followed that 2 lifetime victory. She ran okay against these condition claimers. Jose Garofalo has Sammy Camacho, who's been riding in great form. And Flashing Diamond was really solid, you know, behind Talk That Talk at this level and distance for Embassy Al and Steve Cliceris.
We've had Airball as we transition to our second and final turf race on the program this afternoon in race number 8. We've got a spot where Airball, I think, is the most talented horse in the race. What concerns me a little and just we'll show you her last start. She's coming out of a victory. War Star was a third in this race. She basically sits on the rail, closes, kind of sucks up for third. But Airball ran great in this race, and there's just no doubt in my mind she is on a 1-to-1-to-1 comparison. She is the most talented mare in this spot. Where things might get a little sticky, though, where they get interesting, will she have to just go too fast as the best speed and the best horse? I'm a little worried the 5, Charlie Anna, and to an extent the number 11, Cats Astray, may go after her early. I'm hoping even if she gets caught in like a 3-way pace battle, her class comes through and she'll win again. But we both obviously see the race eye to eye. And as I was saying, Ronnie, she's the best horse, the best speed. But with the 1 True Heiress, her form's been pretty good of late. And she may get the best trip out of anybody in this race.
Well, she has come off the pace in the past to defeat Airball. To sit that trip again. I'm going to show you stat, but on Airball, on Carlos David, just over the past year, a winner last out all levels. He's good. He's 25%, 70% in the money, 197. But you're right. If someone goes up and looks Airball in the eye, True Heiress has got a chance to just close. Did it once before. Julio Cartagena is the trainer. Got Victor LeBron in the saddle today. And I closed it out with the 4 Mercy Side, who's dropping to this level against State Bred Obstacle Clay. Track the pace, finished fifth against very much tougher for Safi. Marcos Meneses, who he seems to be riding on a regular basis now, will be in the saddle.
And Marcos riding perhaps the horse to beat in addition to Kukulkan. He's got that identifier in the Sea of Tranquility here tomorrow afternoon, and looking to maybe set something up, a little pre-race interview with Marcos. We'll see if he wants to do it there. But he's riding well, and absolutely, he's picked up some traction with Safi, without a doubt. Now, we've got Safi in the mix. We've also got trainer Carlos David in the mix as we cap the Friday card on this July 17th with a group of older claimers. And what complicates this race for me, or I think the main sort of pre-race bullet, is trying to gauge and figure out who might be the best at this point in time come like 4:15 this afternoon, because you've got a number of horses like Dizzy Gillespie, who I picked, the 8 Just Kidding, the 10 Diamond Bachelor, who have a lot of back class, but for whatever reason, they might not be coming in off great efforts, including your horse, who was beaten on a big drop for Safi last time out as a big odds-on favorite.
Yeah, moving to Carlos Davis's barn after the claim, stumbled at the start in that race, finished second as the 3-to-5 favorite at this level and distance. Let's keep with the Carlos David stats going this afternoon. First after the claim on the dirt, he's 4-for-10, 40%, 60% in the money, almost $4 is the return of investment. I used 2-step slew on the ticket for Rohan Crichton. And Dizzy Gillespie, this is one of these horses I've been chasing since this horse started running. Yeah, when I pick him, he doesn't win. When I don't pick him, he wins.
Well, he's had a real troubling trend, and I think it needs to be stated, much like Just Kidding, who took a precipitous drop for Safi, stumble or no stumble, was badly beaten last time, or comfortably beaten at 3-to-5. He's got issues in my mind, as does my top pick, the 4 Dizzy Gillespie, who clearly, Ronnie, over his last couple, as a 42-race older gelding veteran, he's been a little obstreperous, and he's been a little capricious in and around the starting gate. Does that happen again this afternoon?
Yeah, and he's an 11-time winner, and I think what Peter does is spot him perfectly in his non-winners of a race since January 17th. So I think it's a good spot for Dizzy Gillespie, and I used every horse we've been talking about. I had the 10 and 4th. I used those 3 on the Stronic 5 ticket this afternoon and on my Rainbow 6. I thought the race went between 8, 3, and the number 4.
All right, that'll do it for us here on Gulfstream today. We'll take a little time out and send it up to track announcer Pete Aiello for those scratches and changes.